Can I leave this here? Can everybody hear me still?
Yes.
All right. I want to say thank you so much for coming this morning to join us. Tech Collective and Bridge have worked together for over a year now to make this day happen, make this report happen. For those of you who don't know, Tech Collective is the industry association for Rhode Island and the IT and bioscience industries. We work to foster workforce development and industry development to drive company growth and individual growth and the economy forward here in Rhode Island. So we're glad you can join us here today to kind of help us accomplish that mission and to showcase some of the work we've been doing and how we can move forward together to drive this industry. I'd like to just do a few housekeeping notes. One is that the restrooms, if anybody needs them, are just right across the atrium hallway. And while we're having our first report on the survey findings and then our panel discussion, if anybody has any questions, please feel free to interject. We'll have an interactive conversation and make it beneficial for everybody. At this time, I'd like to introduce Joe Devine, who is going to take the remarks.
Thanks so much, Giselle. I'm going to look at my notes because I don't trust myself to remember everything I want to say. There's so much we'd like to talk about. First of all, welcome you all here. Thank you so much for coming. We thought about this day years ago. We were hoping we'd have maybe 20, 25 people in the room that really were concerned about this. And obviously, there's a lot more concern, a lot more thought and action going into improving the science education and jobs in Rhode Island. How's that? Better? I'll speak louder. Thanks. All right, so I want to kind of give you an idea of how we got here. Bridge Technical Talent is an IT staffing firm. We've been based in Rhode Island for 14 years. 5 years ago, 6 years ago, we started working with startup companies. And as we were working with those companies, we're really kind of intrigued and, of course, excited about some of the possibilities. When you work with a startup company, they talk about how they're going to grow, their hockey stick type curve growth they're expecting. And we're talking at several levels, 4 or 5 at a time, and they're all talking about needing to have somebody, this right now, I'm going to get a developer right now, usually a pretty special developer, not a regular run-of-the-mill developer, but some special talent. And, you know, in a couple of months, we're going to need a second or third, you know, things go well, we're going to need maybe 10, 15, and the year after that, who knows how many will be. So we're talking a bunch of these companies, and it's hard to find, in some cases, that 1 or 2 unique individuals they're looking for in Rhode Island. Never mind, what if they do take off? And some of them have, and unfortunately some of them have moved. Some of them have gone up to Boston because they couldn't find the talent they needed here. Some of them have stayed, and not all of them succeeded the way they wanted to, but that kind of got the thought going about what should we be doing about this. So we immediately started looking at where you would look to get. Where do you get more students from? We looked to the colleges. You know, we started talking to the department chairs and the deans of those computer science, computer information systems programs. And we were kind of surprised because our expectation was we're going to hear things like, we don't have enough money, we don't have enough computers, we don't have enough teachers or space. Well, we didn't hear that. We heard we have plenty of teacher space, computers, we just need more students. You know, we have roughly half capacity for what we could be. And that was pretty exciting and also kind of discouraging at the same time. But the exciting part was, well, all we got to do is get the word out, right? So we started working on an awareness program to try to get folks aware of what's going on with opportunities in computer science and tried to break some of those myths and some of those maybe barriers that people would traditionally think about. And we went after trying to get more students involved. Women, first of all, you know, 1 out of 4 women are involved, and less than 10% are minority students that are coming into this career. So we started working on that kind of stuff. But along the way, we thought, wouldn't it be nice to also inform these college programs about what are the needs of the industry? A lot of the programs, all the programs have an academic advisory board. You know, they meet once a year, sometimes twice a year. They have a few folks from industry come in. But we thought, wouldn't it be nice to get a wider and deeper look at what are the technology skills that are needed in Rhode Island so that, you know, some schools can enact those, some might choose not to, but at least they would know what they were. So at this time, I just want to recognize the folks that we were initially working with are from 7 outstanding schools in our state that have computer science or computer information systems programs. And first of all, 3 of our state schools, CCRI, Rhode Island College, University of Rhode Island, working with us. We have Johnson & Wales University, and Roger Williams University, New England Tech, and Bryant University. And that core group has been working together for almost 5 years now. And it's amazing to see what you would think as competitors working for a common goal. And they're kind of leaving behind their individual needs at the door and working on common problems for a shared solution for our state. I just wanted to give a tip of the hat to them at the beginning. While we were working together, we applied for this Governor's Workforce Board grant, and when we did that, we came up with we kind of forced us to think about what would we do if we had money? You know, how do we get more students? What would we do if we had the money? And we worked on this grant, which was intended to get businesses and academia working together. And one of the objectives, one of the things that we would fund is this survey. And we thought if we could survey these folks and bring people together after accumulating some data to understand what are the technical skills, and then get the communication channel open between academia and the business environment, and find a way to jumpstart that, that'd be a great thing. And that's kind of how we got here today. We're hoping that this is really just the beginning of the data collection. We we put this together with a bunch of professionals that I'll mention later when we talk about the report itself. It's not a complete report. Obviously, there's a lot of questions we could have asked. There's a lot of answers that probably weren't even thought about asking at the time. But it's the beginning of the data. And there could be some other avenues where this data will be better collected in the future. And you're going to hear about one of those in a minute. One of the nice things about the solution you get with Opportunity at Work and in a tech hire, RI, is instead of us having to ask questions, our employers can go there, post their jobs, post their needs. So instead of us not knowing about what we've got to ask about a particular job or framework, you can tell us what those frameworks are. So that way, the whole state can begin working in that stuff right off the bat. So there's a lot of programs that are happening right now. Probably have all heard about CS4RI, and there's a whole bunch of things that are happening, and I don't want to talk about them because you're going to hear about them in a minute. But the reason we asked these folks to come today to talk to you about those programs is we wanted to make sure that as all these different trains are running down the track in Rhode Island, and everybody's trying to do great things around computer science, education, and jobs, it's like, let's make sure we're all checking in with each other, make sure we're trying to find ways to be opportunistic, to help each other, to avoid areas of conflict, look for areas of synergy, and in general, just try to keep the overall training of computer science, jobs, and education around moving forward. So we're going to have those folks talk in a minute. The way the agenda is going to go today is after they talk, we're going to come back up, and we're going to present a brief snippet of the report. And then after that, we're going to have an outstanding panel discussion. We're so excited to have some folks come here from industry, renowned in the industry, from these computer science programs in our academic institutions to get this conversation started. So at this point, please join me welcoming Jen Hetzel-Silver from Opportunity Work and Lee Bichette, who is working with Commerce RI and URI.
So can folks in the back hear me if I don't use the mic? Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, so I tried to juggle a mic and a clicker last week,
or
it didn't go so well. So we'll go ahead and start this way. So my name is Lee Bichette. I work with Commerce Rhode Island and URI as a senior advisor focused on tech talent and industry development. I want to just provide a brief overview of all the existing efforts in the state as kind of a baseline to the deeper dive that Joe and Giselle will present later. But before doing that, I did want to thank our hosts at the Tech Collective. I also wanted to give a special shout out to Joe Devine. For those that don't know Joe, he's been working tirelessly on this topic for years. I met Joe a few years ago, and he just does it with the greatest intentions, a real sincere focus on diversity in tech. And I just think we need more Joe Devines in Rhode Island, so I just want to do a round of applause. And it worked. So to start the conversation, just wanted to make the point that tech talent is not just a challenge in Rhode Island. This is a national issue. Every state and city and metro struggles with this, and this is projected to continue. It's also important to mention that Rhode Island does offer some benefits to employers today. In addition to having access to a wealth of talent both here as well as 7 minutes that way in southern Massachusetts, great mix of universities, we also have some significant cost benefits. It's cheaper to hire here, it's faster to hire here than in many places, and the retention rates are very high. Think about that bumper sticker with the Rhode Island anchor. Well, people don't leave Rhode Island, and once they get a tech job, they often don't leave that job. But still, to that point, the governor and the leadership team recognize that tech talent is still a place where we can better meet the needs of employers today. And we can actually use this as a competitive advantage to attract employers to the state. So in a very short time, this has become a major priority for the governor's office, and they've worked on these initiatives that I'll describe briefly. So starting on the left, it's important to see that this covers the entire spectrum. from the important work at K-12 straight through skilling up our current workforce. Joe mentioned CS for Rhode Island. This program aims to have computer science in every public school, not every high school, every K-12 school by the end of 2017. This would make Rhode Island the first state to do this. I talk to a lot of employers in my role, and this is critically important to employer decisions around investing in Rhode Island, that long-term talent pipeline. P-TECH is an interesting program. It targets middle school students who might not have college in their future plans. And it gives them an alternative pathway where they can choose a different high school experience that includes a free associate's degree granted by CCRI. And following that, students can go into tech or they can go into higher ed or further their higher ed. And then Tech Hire, you may be familiar with. This is a White House initiative. It's a national initiative focused on helping people who do not have that traditional bachelor's degree in computer science and help them through the best-in-class training, the best-in-class hiring processes to find a way into tech. But the important thing here is we are not just part of this program. With our friends at Opportunity at Work, we're actually building the national model for tech hire right here in Rhode Island. The Real Jobs Rhode Island program is a major funding source and a differentiator for Rhode Island that allows us to do that. And this is actually quite a big deal. You'll hear more about it from Jen as she presents when I hand it off. Many of you will have worked with the partners listed here and know them and work with them on an ongoing basis. The important point is we are working on this initiative in a very collaborative way, and it includes people and organizations that have very diverse perspectives and capabilities, and this is going to be critical to the success of these programs. So, who heard about the news regarding General Electric? Raise your hands. Pretty good coverage. So this is, I've been smiling for 2 days. This is really important. General Electric is bringing hundreds of jobs here. And these aren't back office jobs, these are advanced tech jobs living at the intersection between computer science, analytics, applied math, engineering. And this happened because of a lot of the efforts underway. So that's why this conversation today is so important. Because we collectively, employers, education, everyone in this ecosystem needs to work together to meet the needs of employers that are here in Rhode Island today and the employers that want to come and create jobs here. Okay, so I'm going to do a quick visual of how this all fits together and then I'll pass it over to Jen. My background is in software product management, so I can't host a presentation without a flowchart. So this is the flowchart. On the right-hand side, you see the traditional path into tech, you know, K-12, higher ed, into tech. On the left-hand side, you see continuing education, other training aimed at skilling up the current workforce. So this is how traditionally people got into tech in Rhode Island. With CS for Rhode Island, you see us building that pipeline from K-12, getting students exposed to computer science. It's a major issue, just exposure, getting them interested in it, getting them prepared to succeed in it. And that's going to have more students choose computer science for a career in a higher education pathway. Here you can visualize that alternative pathway that P-TECH provides. So students in middle school now get excited. They can choose a P-TECH high school, get that associate's degree for free, and then either go into tech or go into the bachelor's programs. And then finally, very closely aligned with today's event, we're also working at the question, how do we get more of our college graduates, you know, graduating with tech skills, graduating with analytic skills, with computer science skills and related skills? So this is the focus of today's event. One specific thing that we're working on very actively is creating new minors that are practical, that align with employer needs, and that have an employer capstone so we can create those relationships between employers and those students. Before I pass it to Jen, I wanted to say, if you're interested in that topic, please come and grab my card. I'd love to work with you on that from any perspective of interest. So with that, I'll have Jen tell you how Tech Hire fits in. Thank you.
Thank you. Everyone hear me okay? So my name is Jen Hetzel-Silver, and I'm here representing Opportunity at Work, the nonprofit that is facilitating the build-out of Tech Hire nationwide. So to be clear, there are 50 communities nationwide now, more to be announced later this month. And Rhode Island is super special among those 50 communities because we are the only state, the only community out of the 50 that Governor Raimondo stood up and said, you know what, make us your learning lab. This is the place where we put a full team on three people full time on the ground, not to build a program, but to build an ecosystem. And that's where all of this ties together. So one of the first things we do is really understand what's in demand. And so what you see are these arrows pointing down. So all these many different programs in place, we're all about collecting the data, knowing specifically what IT jobs are out there and coming, and what are the concrete skills that are needed to do those jobs superbly well. So imagine a future where not only do we have GE Digital coming to town, but even more companies coming. And this is the place to really see and incubate that talent, because the signal is so accurate. It's always relevant, right? And then building on that signal, we build the programs that are hyper-relevant. And this is where we have our tech electives and our launch codes and apprenticeship RI. We have accelerated training programs. We have Year Up. The list goes on and on. It's about creating a system that both connects current programs and helps them to scale their impact in ways that are hyper-relevant to that demand signal I showed you earlier. And we do that because we're working together. We're sharing all of that information across every program. Information is now transparent and accessible like never before. And I'm going to show you in a little bit how we actually gather that data and how any one of you here can help us get more of it so that that signal is even more relevant going forward. Four pillars upon which everything we do stands, okay? And all four of these pillars are connected to our number one goal, which is to place 2,000, not more, Rhode Islanders into in-demand tech jobs in the next 5 years. And we know that not a single program or institution can do that single-handedly, right? That we really have to build an ecosystem to do that together. So first pillar, employer engagement. We want to know what skills you have in demand, and we want to help you accelerate your hiring channels so that you can hire quickly and with superb talent matching. Second pillar, job seekers. We believe that mastery trumps pedigree. We believe that there are many pathways, conventional and unconventional, to getting people these meaningful jobs, and that we need to create more net new talent. So we're not always having to poach as a way of finding new talent to fill our jobs. So that's where we say, if you can do the job, if you can prove you can do the job, you can get the job. We'll help you get that job. That mastery trumps pedigree. And we're helping screen in versus screen out the hiring process. Third pillar, education. And this is where Lee hinted on the CS, the work we're doing with higher ed and so forth. We are scanning the country high and low, in addition to the education programs we already have in Rhode Island, to look for best-in-class boot camps, certification programs. What are those alternative methods that are working? And more importantly, how are they vetting and assessing talent to ensure that the right talent gets fit with our employers? So it's not just about including more people into this pipeline to grow that net new talent, but ensuring it's top-notch. And lastly, funding. That's where we work with our state and local partners, government agencies, to make sure the incentives for talent retention are all tied together. You may have heard of Wavemaker Fellowship for encouraging students to stay in state if they get employed and accept a position in Rhode Island. There's other incentives to our employers who hire locally as well. We need to make sure that all of these many moving parts are all sewn together. And the first step to getting that is starting here. And it's techhireri.org. This is a new platform just launched last month. And if you start anywhere, if you remember anything from this, what I have to say this morning, remember this website. The more employers, and by employers, I also mean our higher ed institutions who we know are hiring for tech positions, the more that go to this platform and tell us what specific job categories do exist in your organization. And then, depending on which job category you select, we'd like to know, A, does it require a four-year credential or not? It helps understand what those hiring practices are. And second, we'd like to know what specific IT skills are needed for each of those occupational categories. It takes 5 to 10 minutes to complete, and here's what you get when it's done. A dashboard. This dashboard, again, information, open market, available to everyone. Real-time updates all year long. And in fact, over time, we're going to have dashboards even more customized by education partner, by employer, and so forth. So here's what we know today, okay? Of the 1,722 jobs that Burning Glass tells us are in Rhode Island currently, we've heard about 370 of them. In other words, that's from the employers, the 166 employers that have signed on and are working with us through our many partners, Tech Collective and beyond, okay? So in other words, about 21% of the data, we know where those jobs are. Our goal is to get that 21% as close as possible to 100%, so that all those skills, those top skills requested by employers that you see on the far right, are hyper-relevant and accurate. so that all of our higher ed institutions continue to align concretely, hyper-relevant, to what our employers want and need to hire locally. And that those boot camps and other training programs that we're bringing to Rhode Island, that otherwise wouldn't have noticed us, by the way, had we not had so much tech talent pipeline being as robust as it is here, that'll be more relevant too. But it takes engagement from all of you and spreading the word of how important it is. Go to that platform, send your bat signal, and then help us help the whole ecosystem grow together. One quick example of that, how it's all tied together. Many of you may have heard this story. It's been in the news. Mozart. Mozart graduated from Ace Academy. He even went to Steambox after school. Great computer science focus. He tried out Wentworth Institute, but he couldn't afford it, so he ended up dropping out his first year. Also got lucky with an internship from Google, but that was fleeting. Come January this past year, he meets up with Real Jobs Rhode Island partner, LaunchCode, which happens to be right across the street from where we are today. And they vet him and assess him and help him with his resume skills. In less than a month, Mozart was matched to Kenzen Media up in Northern Rhode Island and got matched for the job. So had he not been matched, Mozart would have been placed in all host of programs with all of our partners for remedial training, supports, you name it. This is what it's all about. Finding conventional talent, conventional pathways in higher ed, as well as those less conventional ones in ways that create more net new talent. We have a host of employers, over 160 and growing, that are working with Year Up, Tech Collective, Apprenticeship RI, and LaunchCode. This list grows by the day, literally. In fact, I need to get GE up there soon. And how you can help. Employers, send your bat signal. And remember, when I say employer, that means anyone who hires IT, regardless of what type of industry or organization you work in. Review applicants. Be willing to consider applicants trained and assessed by our partners. Okay? Be willing to engage in conversations and advise. So, for example, in a few weeks, we're hosting a design sprint because we've got our platform up and running. It's version one, and we know version two can be much better, but we don't know what we don't know. Help us co-create the ideal platform of the future. I mean, even imagine, right? Anyone who uses Lyft or Uber, and you know how good it feels when you see that little car coming your way because you know. Imagine what it's going to look like when you see that job seeker, that student coming your way with the talent you know are going to be matched for you. That's the platform and what's coming. Provide coaching, and of course, leverage the Commerce Corps incentives galore that are out there. Education and training partners, continue to align with the data that's out there. And we're giving you, you're going to hear more about that today and more that's coming with our dashboard. Explore new models of learning and software and analytic skills and in ways that are more accelerated. Let's connect our students and alumni to new job search and placement resources. We've got lots of them. We want to work with you on that. And lastly, be sure to tell your seniors and alumni about the Rhode Island's Wavemaker Fellowship Program, so that anyone who stays in Rhode Island has an incentive financially otherwise to keep work here. So that about wraps it up for me. I'm gonna turn it back over to Giselle. Keep that back signal going in a way that everybody wins. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to continue the conversation. And thank you very much for coming today. I'm a mom of two kids. This stuff matters to me because we wanna make Rhode Island a place where education and employability really thrive. Thank you very much for your commitment to this work.
All right, so at this point, we're going to do a quick review, and I do mean quick, right? We're not going to do the whole report. Hopefully, you guys would pick up a copy of it. Unfortunately, there may not be enough for everybody here today. We definitely expect this many folks coming. Very appreciative that you did. We'll print more. It's going to be available on the Tech Collective and the Bridge website as well. All right, so I'm going to kind of go through a little bit of the report, and then Giselle's going to go through our recommendations. First thing I want to mention is, the folks who helped put this thing together initially, back when we were working with the colleges, and then we decided to do this survey, we needed to find some IT professionals that were willing to put some time in outside of their jobs, their everyday, 50, 60-hour week type grind jobs, to kind of help us define what should we be doing. And just quickly take through that process, we pulled a team together, and I'm going to mention some of them, recognize them in a moment, but we went out, we did some early conversations. And we met with CIOs and directors of technology to kind of understand what was going on in their world to kind of inform what we wanted to find. And the most surprising thing for me as we met with these folks was that our focus had been technology. My experience in manufacturing and electronic manufacturing before getting into IT, I was used to every year updating our tech track. Every year we take a look at it. What are we doing? What's our competition doing? Where's the industry headed? How do we make sure that our design skills and our manufacturing and testing skills were keeping pace with the industry? So we thought we want to do the same thing for IT in Rhode Island. How do we make sure that the skills that are needed today and in the future will be represented by the graduates? The more people we talked to, not that that wasn't important, but equally important, we found workforce readiness skills to be just as important and lacking for a lot of people. That was probably my biggest takeaway. We'll talk more about that in a few minutes. But yeah, so the folks who helped us so much from the beginning, some of them here and some of them, unfortunately, not able to be here today, but from UNFI, Tony Constantino was a big help on the tech side all the way around. Brian Boder, who's not here from Newark, helped us out a lot. Ernie Gaines from Brave River, also not able to be here today, but a big supporter of Tech Collective, helped us out a lot. Henry Hodge from HCH Enterprises did a lot with information security for us. Matt Zanny also did a lot of work with us, most recently with Clarity Software. Pippa Shett helped us as well with a lot of work, and Chris Shoemaker as well at the end, writing our report. But the person who really, I'm probably forgetting a few people, but the person who really helped us, helped me the most, you know, right from the beginning, helped recruit half of our team of people I just mentioned, helped keep people positive and energized, helped pull people together on some of those hot summer days we were working on this project, was Lisa Duda from Schneider. And I would definitely like to recognize her as we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for her, so thank you so much. And having said that, the other big thank you has to go to Tech Collective. This group that we just talked about, well-intentioned folks trying to put this thing together, working hard to make it happen, but really, for-profit businesses, you know, and this wasn't our primary objective. This wasn't our, we wake up in the morning and let's get this done first. Until we really partnered with the Tech Collective, and in particular Giselle, and later Amanda, who's not able to be here today either, we would not be here today if we hadn't met with them about a year or so ago. And from where we were to get here today in about a year is amazing, and we really, really appreciate that help and support. All right, so enough of that. Wanted to make sure that you know we're not going to go through this page by page. If you look at the next slide, I'm sorry, I don't have a controller. Okay, so these are the several areas we're going to talk about. Demographics, what are some of the hiring practices? We really want to see what are people doing to recruit these entry-level IT professionals. Spend a little bit of time on workforce readiness, a small chunk of technology hiring, and then Giselle will do their recommendations. All right, so with the demographics, we were very pleased with the response. We sent out a lot of requests for this, but we got over 70 back. And you can see from this graph, there's a nice distribution of industries that are represented. There's a great distribution by size as well. Roughly half of the 70 respondents were companies with under 100, and about half were over 100 employees. And you can pick any arbitrary number, but that's a pretty good size to show. We've got small business represented, and we get some of our enterprise business as well. The other thing that I really liked about this was when we think about IT, and in particular when we speak to students and educators and parents about trying to encourage them to get their students or their children into IT, we talk about this being across the spectrum. Almost every company has an IT need, and it's not just IT companies. So the results of having the respondents rather being in both IT companies as well as about 3/4 not in IT companies, but companies that need IT to grow their business and to be competitive in their marketplaces. It was really nice to see we got a nice mix. That's about a good fair mix of how the companies really are out there. And you can see all these different industries. So hiring practices. Let's see if I keep up my notes, make sure I catch up what I want to say again. So recruiting, we said that the way that companies recruit, the methods that they use, on campus is still the number one thing. You know, actually being there for interviews or using on-campus career service type offices is clearly well in a way the number one way that folks are doing that. But also things like job sites, online job sites, And word of mouth are the next two biggest things that were chosen. Surprisingly, that word of mouth is still that important in this day and age, but just goes to show. But the fact that these folks are still looking primarily at colleges, but not just at colleges, in terms of education, four-year degrees were important, but they weren't critical. They were pretty much the number one choice, but there was many, many other alternatives that were picked as well, including two-year degrees and minors and other non-traditional paths that you heard about a few minutes ago. And when we asked the question, we allowed folks to pick as many choices as they wanted because they have different jobs, different entry-level jobs. Some might require a four-year degree and some don't. And I'm thinking off the top of my head, it was probably like 52 or 55% or so of the opportunities don't require a four-year IT education. So that opens up an enormous opportunity for some of these non-traditional pathways, as well as what Lisa was talking about, getting, you know, CS or CIS minors in more hands of graduating students. We hear so much today about the value or the ROI of a college education. You know, there's a good case to be made if you take any degree and you add a CS or CIS minor to it, that's a lot more valuable because there's going to be a need for that student when they get out right away. So I wanted to really focus on that, and Lee mentioned he's available, he's trying to put a program together in the state with URI and other schools to really intentionally build more of these minor programs. Talking about internships, I do want to refer back to my numbers here. Only 11 employers out of the 70 said that internships was a primary way that they pick higher, they use for recruiting their IT entry-level employees. But in a separate question, 33 companies said that they have internships, and 22 of them also hire entry-level employees. And I will tell you anecdotally, talking to companies, this is an important area for companies to assess students, for students to assess the environment that they may or may not be working in when they graduate. And we would definitely encourage more of these programs, internship programs. They take resources. Clearly, you know, we do internships around Gridge, and it definitely takes resources. It takes time and commitment because those folks need to be fed. They need to be watered and fertilized, and they need something every day. So, but if you can afford that, you'll be able to recruit your student right off the bat. Unfortunately, there were some companies that don't hire at the entry level. The number one reason far and away was that their jobs required previous experience, and that's what you would expect. But also, if you dig deeper and you look at some of the other answers to that question, when you get to that section of the report, you'll see that there's a lot of things around budget and around resources. And similar to an internship, an entry-level employee needs that care and feeding. You know, they don't have, in all cases, the workforce readiness skills that they need. They need to be developed before they can really be contributing to their team. And there's probably very little we can do about that, except to recognize that maybe this, if we can get some more of these workforce readiness skills built in, then maybe we would find more companies hiring them coming out of school. All right, so jumping right to workforce readiness skills. Again, this was an area that surprised me when I was working on the pre-survey with some of our CIOs and directors. And what came out of the survey maybe wasn't so surprising when you start thinking about the workforce readiness skills. The top two, far and away, were these two up here: problem solving, critical thinking, and being able to work as part of a team and being able to communicate with your coworkers. Far and away, the two biggest responses. If you think about number one, I think we can probably all agree that if somebody's going through a CS or a CIS program, they're probably getting plenty of critical thinking and plenty of problem solving skill development during that program. I don't think we have to focus too much more on that particular area. But in terms of teamwork and ability to communicate with employers, there's definitely an opportunity to grow the amount of attention that we pay to this area. And I want to go back to an earlier comment I made about talking to these hiring people, the directors and so forth. They were adamant that if they would be willing to give up some technical depth, they'd be willing to give up some of the technical knowledge if they could get these teamwork skills and some of these communication skills in their students so they can hit the workforce running at a better pace. There are some great things that are already going on. I just want to highlight a couple of examples just as an element of, you know, here's something happening so we can maybe learn from what we've already seen and maybe take that, use it, or grow on it in some other places. But at New England Tech, few years ago, they received a grant from the Davis Foundation. And basically what this grant allowed them to do was, on a class-by-class basis, they intentionally went to their curriculum. They took a look at what is the content that we're trying to communicate to these students. And they found a way to engage with students outside of the classroom to kind of get them to engage in some of the content learning on their own for about 10 to 15% of the content they were trying to communicate. Then they used that extra time in classes, in classroom experiences, to build teams to encourage more project work and some intentional project work and communication work to build those workforce skills. They also took the teachers, professors separately, and they worked with them in a seminar type environment to understand better how to engage with these folks. And the bottom line here, let's see if I can, the overarching goal was content's important, but student learning is more important. And the development of these skills, being intentional in the curriculum, has shown success there. And that may be an example that we could all learn from. And by the way, I also want to give a shout out to New England Tech, as I mentioned this, for videotaping us today. Appreciate you guys bringing those resources here so we can have this available for other folks later. So the other thing about these skills, we don't have to wait until folks get to college before we start talking about them and working on them. And in fact, some students won't go to college, right? There's going to be lots of other pathways, and it's important that everybody understands workforce readiness skills. And I work with an organization called PASA, the Providence After School Alliance. They have been intentionally working with their middle school students and their high school students in after school and summer programs. And their whole objective is to be this funnel that allows programs to be delivered and content to be delivered to students, not just in computer science, but and not just STEM, but in the arts and in sciences, athletics, there's all kinds of things. But all of those different programs have a couple of key features that are important. First of all, they provide a lot of structure and security for the parents and the students who are in these programs. But every student gets assessed with an assessment program which assesses them on 5 of these workforce readiness skills. 2 of them are the ones that we find most important, and 3 others. And they're doing this at the beginning and the end of programs, and they are seeing definite improvement in these workforce readiness skills. So whether these students go on to college or whether they go right to the workforce, they're going to be better prepared. We've got to find a way to be more intentional in our K-12 programs, both in school, after school, and summertime, but trying to find a way to build these skills into those students. So, it's not going to be any one area's burden. It should be the college's burden, it should be the workforce burden, it's the parents' burden. It should be everybody's to kind of build it together. All right, so I'm just going to take a second on this graph. You can find this in your report as well. This came right out of the report. So we looked at, technically, going back to the original reason for this report, it was to try to dive deep, find out what are the technical skills that are needed in our industry to make sure that the colleges that were preparing their students directly for jobs could get this data, and the schools that maybe aren't preparing them directly to use a certain technology could be informed about, well, this, if we have to make a choice between what technology to use, maybe we'll pick one that's in demand, as well as, you know, providing algorithmic thinking and computational thinking that they're trying to communicate to their computer scientists. So one of the questions we asked in all 6 of these domains, and you can see what they are, one of the questions was, are you hiring now or in the future? And what this graph is trying to show is the red answers are we need people right now. We have job openings today. And moving across to 1 to 2 years or 2 to 5 years, or no. It was an answer for no as well. And when you look at this, you see, well, they're all doing some hiring. I think there were 17 companies that were hiring in more than one of these 2 domains, which is amazing. But we're going to talk only about 2 of these and just give you a brief idea about 2 of these. We're going to pick the 2 that are doing the most hiring now. You can see App Dev and Service Desk are the 2 areas that are clearly looking for more folks today. We're just going to dive in really shallow and take a look at what some of these 2 areas are talking about. There's a lot more data in the report. We're also going to release a compilation of every question and every answer. So you'll be able to see all of the data, which will be available on our websites again. But they're not in there. We didn't write it in there. It was, I think, 50 questions. We didn't want to bog down the report. But even in the report, there's a ton of information. All right, so App Dev, you know, this goes back to the original genesis for the survey. You know, we were looking for programmers. We couldn't find enough developers. This is the one area, when you look at those million jobs that are needed, a big swath of those are developers, programmers. So this is a really important slide. when we looked at the general skills, of course, you know, understanding particular languages is important to it, as you would expect. You know, knowing certain stacks are important. Knowing particular tools are, of course, important. But the thing that can really set people apart, we found out, was the ability to read and write technical specifications. And that maybe isn't something that was so intuitive. So for any of you with the young aspiring programmers, or that have curriculum programs, you know, this might be an area that could give them a leg up if they are able to read and write these technical specifications. Talking about specific skills, as you would expect, the Microsoft and Java stacks were two of the biggest stacks that were out there. You can take a look at the report to see all the specific skills that went into those stacks. But also mobile, web front end, scripting, also decent needs in terms of what's being looked for out there. Those kind of skills, you know, if they have those scripting skills, will definitely make the candidate more appealing to businesses. And finally, service desk. So 34% of the companies, about a third of the companies, said they have a service desk. We also see this is a definite area where a lot of companies hire at entry level. They're looking for folks that come on board. They're going to do break fix work. They're going to do help desk work. They're going to maybe go out and meet people that are users of technology, help them with problems from whatever, you know, from broken mouse to bigger and more complex issues. There's a tiered system for most companies where they come in at a low level and they slowly move up the chain to various levels of responsibility. Some of the specific things that they're looking for are operating systems, being able to use backup and restore devices, and maybe some of the other ones that are important to those folks as well. But you know, for the person that's not a developer, that has gone through an information systems type of degree, computer science program, that isn't really sure where they want to take their career, this is a nice place to start because they get exposure to lots of different skills, and they'll be able to kind of, you know, then map out where they want to take their career. All right, so before we go to recommendations, any questions or any thoughts? Just go right to recommendations.
So, you know, in creating the recommendations, our findings are not really that new. We all know we need technical skill sets. We all know we need workforce skill sets, work readiness, soft skills, business skills. Our technical skill sets are not that new either. We kind of all learn the trenches. We know what kind of skills are out there. The significance of this report and this survey is to put all that comprehensively into one place. So we can all be working together towards a common goal, to work with Tech Hire, to work with Lee, URI, Commerce RI, to do all the things that we're trying to do together as an ecosystem, and have one common referral point and set of action items. So that's where our recommendations come forward, and Rhode Island is really the perfect place to do it. We are small, we all know each other, everybody knows everybody in this room, and it's a perfect test bed. Obviously, Tech Hire already recognized that fact. So it's kind of nice that we can be in this room together and move forward together. We have about seven, well, not about, there are seven recommendations in the report. On a very high level, I'm going to talk through the seven, and you can read more about them in the report itself. And the goal of these recommendations is to fill those 2,000 jobs that Jen talked about. It's to fill the jobs that RI Online data says of the top 50 fastest growing jobs, at least five of them are in the IT fields. So there's a lot of opportunity out there, and we are charged and we have responsibility as educators and employers in the state to fill them. The recommendations, first one, increase career awareness and engagement. Students don't know what they don't know. A lot of students only know what their parents do for a living. They don't know a lot about IT. Conversely, if parents don't know about IT, when their student comes home and say, oh, I want to be an app developer, I want to be a game designer, we don't want to say, oh, those jobs are not in Rhode Island, those jobs are overseas. Those jobs are in Rhode Island, those jobs are here, they're viable, well-paying jobs with futures in them, right? Sustainable jobs. So just raising awareness and engagement overall is key. Identifying women and minorities who can be role models for students. You know, not to be stereotypical, but IT industry is very heavily white male dominated. We need to show that there are other people entering this industry and dispel the myth that you can be a woman in the industry. You don't have to be a geek. You don't have to be super smart. All you have to do is have an aptitude to learn and want to learn and do your best. Identify existing programs in the state that are going on, and scale those up. How can we make those reach more students? Is it money, is it resources, is it employers? How can we scale up existing programs? and making sure we're incorporating both the technical and the workforce readiness skills that are needed into those programs. Recommendation number two, support and increase engagement in the state's IT education initiatives. There's a huge push right now going on with the current administration. There's PTEC, there's CS for Rhode Island. There is the existing academies and IT programs inside the schools that already exist that we need to build upon. In raising those awareness of those programs and student enrollment in those programs, we are bolstering our future workforce. So that's really critical to what we need to be doing, and making sure that those opportunities are there for students who want to pursue continuing education, but also who want to enter the workforce upon graduation. How do we make diverse career opportunities available to students and to employers' hiring needs? Recommendation number three, incorporate in-demand technologies into K-16 education, and then number four, incorporate workforce readiness skills. Again, Joe kind of talked about this with New England Tech and with PASA. How do we identify what those skills are? What is it that makes an employee a great worker? It's your technical knowledge, but it's also the desire to always want to learn, right? In IT, you're always learning. If you stop learning for 6 months, you're already outdated. Our survey of technologies is only partway complete because there's so many more technologies out there than we can ever capture. So how can we instill in our students the desire to continue to learn and the aptitude to be able to do so? Recommendation number five. Speaks directly to what Lee and Joe were talking about with CS Minors at Rhode Island and colleges and universities. It is just another pathway for students to be able to either enter the IT industry or enter business with IT skills. IT impacts the entire industry. It runs across every business and all aspects of businesses. So if you have that background knowledge of IT and tech, you have a leg up against everybody else that you're competing against. How do we build out those programs in Rhode Island, and how do we raise awareness and enrollment in them is our next steps, right? No pressure. Recommendation number six, training opportunities for non-college bound students and transitioning workers. So this is a lot of the Launch Code, Tech Electives, tech course program with the two workforce investment boards, with other stuff that Opportunity at Work and Tech Hire are working on. So how do we put people in non-traditional pathways? So people who have non-traditional backgrounds in either education or workforce or transitioning from other industries that maybe have less opportunities. We get several people in our tech course program who worked at the company for 20 years. Companies don't update their technologies as fast as technology changes. So their skills out of 20 years might be a little outdated. How can we ramp up their skills and get them to re-enter the workforce? How can we get somebody with a telecom background or somebody with a sales background to enter the IT industry? Those skills, transitioning skills, are extremely valuable and give them a leg up on what needs to happen for us. And number seven is establish a statewide academic advisory panel. So today is one of the channels of having industry and academia come together to talk, to share knowledge and best practices, and how can we work together better and more comprehensively to meet our needs, both of our needs mutually. Establishing an academic advisory panel that would meet once or twice a year to continue this conversation, to keep everything relevant all the time, and make connections so that when students are going from K to 12, they're seamlessly going into college and university programs, or they're seamlessly going into entry-level jobs or internships. How can we make that pathway smoother for all of us involved and see more success with students, less dropout, more retention overall for Rhode Island and our economy and workforce? Those are our seven recommendations, again, just at a very high level. Does anybody have any questions? So we're going to segue.
Go right into the panel. We first will introduce our panel quickly, and then have Steve come on up too. Steve, you guys recognize Steve Benkin from WPRO Newsman, kind enough to dedicate his morning to us today to help us moderate this panel. Let's just have a quick introduction for Joan Peckham.
We get the panelists stuff to get them into position. Oh, sure. Why don't we have all the panelists come on up? Can we get the lights turned on too?
Yeah.
Please. All right. I've got everybody else's notes. Now I have mine. Thanks, everybody, for coming. It's great that you could come, and we'll just give our panelists a second to get situated. They don't have a microphone, do they? Maybe I should give it to them and have them pass it around?
Yes.
Is that okay, folks?
Right.
I spend all the time in front of a microphone myself, so we're going to go alphabetically. And Peter, we're going to start with you. So thanks, everybody, for coming. What we're going to do is have the panelists introduce themselves briefly. We'll get the thumbnail sketch of you and your what your involvement is. And then we'll get down into some of the issues that we have, some questions that we have prepared for them, and some questions that you're going to pose to them as well. And hopefully we'll have time to get it all in. We hope to have you out by 11, as promised, so we'll see. My name's Steve Plankin. I'm with WPRO Radio. I'm a reporter, anchor, host. And they've asked me back because a couple of years ago they did a series on Tech Collective Zone first initial survey into the IT needs and asked me to host that, and it was great fun, and I'm back for more fun today, just like
awesome.
You are.
Awesome.
Thanks. So let's start with you, and we'll get you to introduce each other, yourselves briefly with a thumbnail sketch.
Sure. Good morning, everyone. My name is Peter Moreau. I'm the CIO at Amica Mutual Insurance Company. We're based right here in Rhode Island, out of Lincoln. I've been with the company pretty much my whole life. So I was a Marine grad back in the day and went right to Amica, and I've been there my whole career. So I've been the CIO there for about 5 years. I grew up in Rhode Island, so this means a lot to me. I grew up in Cumberland, Rhode Island. So it's really important that we build up our talent. Entry-level hiring is something we do pretty extensively, so be happy to share it with everyone.
All right, great.
Good morning. My name is Chris Shoemaker. I'm the CTO of Mojo Tech. For any of you who don't know, Mojo Tech is a software development consultancy and agency here, headquartered here in Rhode Island. One of my chief roles is hiring. So the talent of our workforce is really the lifeblood of our company as a consultancy. But I also interact with a lot of our clients. Almost all of our clients are building products and then eventually go on or are immediately trying to hire their own employees. So we also kind of consult in that aspect as well. I am sympathetic with them and their troubles about hiring as well.
Chris, excuse me, Chris, is there a better name than Mojo Tech? Come on.
Okay. I don't think there is.
Hi, I'm Joan Peckham. I'm Chair of Computer Science and Statistics at the University of Rhode Island, and I'm a computer scientist myself. I'm also a co-coordinator of the Big Data Initiative at the University of Rhode Island. We're about to propose a data science program. And I was Program Director of Education and Workforce Development at the National Science Foundation for 3 years, 2008 to 2011, where I was very excited to be on the ground floor to help with this national and international definition of computational thinking. So you can imagine my excitement about what's happening in Rhode Island right now. Really great.
My name is Tony Rugo. I'm the Computer Science Program Coordinator for Roger Williams University. I've been at Roger Williams since about 2002, but I've been teaching in the computer science field for about 25 to 30 years now. I also, in addition to working predominantly at the undergraduate level, I also work with computer science program accreditation at a national level. So we do look at computer science programs from California through Connecticut. And one of my primary interests here is how do I get students into my program who are qualified to complete my program in a timely manner? And then how do I get my students who graduate to go on into meaningful, and for me, what I would hope to be a lifelong career in a field of their choosing? Thank you.
All right, great. So Tony, you've got the microphone in your hand, so we're going to start with the first question directed toward the folks in academia. How does your department determine core skills in the classes to offer?
Okay, one of the things we look at is, we're obviously a university, we're an undergraduate focused university, So when I'm looking at how to develop my computer science program, I go to two sources initially. The ACM, which is one of the largest computer science organizations, and then the IEEE, which comes in from the electrical engineering side. They give us a lot of what they consider to be the core skills that a computer science undergraduate degree would entail. We talk to our graduates when they graduate and they get their jobs. It's like, okay, what was our program missing? What would we have given you that we think you could have done better with? We talk to our employers as well as what we're missing and what we need. But also, we also have to respond to university requirements. We are an accredited bachelor's degree. We do have obligations in humanities, science, and arts as well through a general education program. So we can't just say for 120 credit hours we'll do nothing but computer science, because we do have those liberal arts requirements as well. So again, we're looking at the university requirements, professional societies, and then feedback from our graduates and their employers.
Joan, you want to tackle that?
Sure, and all of the above. I mean, I have a list here, and pretty much he covered covered all of those things. But we also are working extensively with K through 12 in the governor's computer science for Rhode Island program, and looking at how we scaffold and how we greet students from K through 12, provide feedback K through 12, and the preparation for the skills that are needed. So that's, you know, one other domain. And we also look to our international partners. There is emerging this whole idea of computational thinking. What are the critical problem solving skills that students need? And there is come to be some agreement on that. And then there's this new area of data science. I just went to a national meeting where scholars from all around the country were thinking about what are the critical problem-solving skills, what should a student know how to do when they leave the university with a degree in data science. And of course, the next thing that I think these scholars need to do is talk to industry. I think it would be very important for us to hear what are the skills that are needed. So,
all right.
Consistent with the public.
All right. Chris, what's missing from your entry-level IT employees?
Well, I guess I could talk about some certain technical things, skills that I find missing, but I think that one of the parts of this report that's really valuable and that I really resonated with was that emphasis about these workforce readiness skills. And I think that, you know, when 89% of the employers cite as the most important workforce competency is problem solving critical thinking, it's necessary to look at that and say, you know, maybe that's actually the problem. I think it's certainly the problem for what I'm trying to hire for, and what I see as a key deficiency. And, you know, we kind of have to sort of draw the inference, like, if employers are having so much trouble hiring, and this is their, you know, the most important criteria, then we have to say this is not a solved problem. And it's too easy to, I think, brush aside and say, oh yeah, problem solving, critical thinking, yeah, everybody learns that, and everybody can do that. And this is not true. And it's not just at the entry level, this is even at the mid-level. You know, I interview folks with 5 years experience that I still think they can't think clearly. And IT especially, and kind of what I do in our business is software development, so application development, that category, it's absolutely critical. The medium is so unconstrained that if you cannot think clearly about what you're doing, you will soon lose yourself. And this is a fundamental skill, and it's too easy to say, just everybody learns that, when they don't. This, I think, a big piece of it is about information management. So, you know, can you take a clear stock of what you know and what you don't know? Can you form hypotheses about what you don't know in order to perhaps learn more about them? Do you recognize when you're making logical inferences? Can you distinguish those between deductions? Can you form an argument, right? Can you form a logical argument where it follows logic, that your conclusion follows from the antecedent? A lot of the people I'm hiring, even, or trying to hire, and looking to interview, can't do this. And it's something that's very difficult to screen for as well, which makes it risky to hire, because if somebody can't do that, it's very difficult to teach them how.
Say it's a shortcoming in analytical thinking or in expressing themselves?
It is. The two are related. Yeah. Usually, if someone doesn't think clearly, they will not be able to speak clearly. The second most important one is, you know, ability to communicate with coworkers. I think that's a big piece of it. In the context of technology, communicating effectively often means thinking clearly first and then expressing that. We have folks that are not particularly strong communicators, and does that limit their career potential? Perhaps in some degree. But if they can think clearly and they can interact with a computer, say programming, they're going to be a productive member of our team and be successful.
You want to point any fingers?
No.
You find this as well?
Sure. I'm going to focus a little bit more. Definitely, as the survey pointed out, problem solving and those types of skills are definitely something that continually needs to be enhanced through the educational process. But the communication piece is really important. The students coming in, our new hires coming in, have done some work with projects and whatnot through the schools, but that's a critical piece of our technology stack today. The way we develop applications, it's very, it's with an agile methodology. And in the agile methodology, it works side by side with not just your coworkers on building out a project. You're working with business people who are co-located within your with you building that application. Now you're talking communication skills are critical because now the actual developers are working side by side with a business person who doesn't understand technology, doesn't understand a lot of these things, and they have to work on things and deliver them on a short-term basis, two-week, month basis. Those are critical skills that need to be continued to enhance. So I'm encouraged by what Joe was reporting. You know, about we need to get more of that into the educational process. If you will.
All right. Well, while you pass that microphone on down to Joan, let's turn back to the academic side. Would your department be willing to find ways to include more workforce readiness skills if it meant less depth in technical areas?
Absolutely. And I can say that it's something that we have been doing for quite a while. Based on input at least a decade ago, a survey of employers said exactly the same thing. That was the time in which we started requiring writing and communications courses in our major. We have a social issues and computing course that students are required to take. But I just had a long conversation with someone by email in Charlotte, North Carolina. He's a high up in Bank of America. And we were talking exactly about this, you know, these workforce readiness skills and going back and forth as industry and academia do. I can tell you that the most important thing for us is the critical problem solving skills. It's something we've always worked on. There was a time in which industry tried to coerce us into teaching the hot skills of the day. Why haven't they had 5 years of programming in this particular environment, this particular language, and so on? Happily, my conversations with industry today are more, we need more of the critical problem-solving skills, and we're very happy to work on the work for its readiness skills. But I think what Joe was talking about earlier, it really takes a community. This is not something that the university can do by themselves. These skills need to begin to be trained in K-12. We will continue to work on that, and we solicit input from industry all the time, figure out how to strengthen it without weakening the critical problem solving skills, which you pointed out are very related to the second item. And also, I would like to urge industry to think about their responsibility, which Joe talked about a little bit also, in taking and helping to train the new employees. Yeah, they'll probably leave you after a certain number of years, but then you're gonna hire someone that another company has trained in these skills. So it's really a patchwork quilt of effort and communities. I just want to put one last plug in for our new general education program at the University of Rhode Island. This is going to be very helpful to us and to you because it's an integrative general education program. The students are required to have courses in which they work on real projects. All the courses are integrative. It's not standalone, a little bit of math, a little bit of science, a little bit of arts, and so on. So I think this is not only going to be helpful for the students, give them more exciting courses, grand challenge courses, for example, are required. It is also going to help to prepare them with these critical thinking skills and workforce readiness skills that I think that, you know, maybe sometimes computer scientists are not the best do exactly all of that. Our colleagues in the other disciplines can help us with that.
As you pass that over to Tony, I'm just curious because I was wondering, as I was looking at the list of recommendations, the last recommendation was the Industry Advisory Committee. No commitment here, but just by a show of hands, who'd be interested in serving on something like that? There'd be a lot of people interested in tackling something like that. Twice a year, it's not so tough. Tony.
Okay, when I read this, it says including more workforce readiness skills, if it meant less depth in technical areas. I don't think there actually needs to be a trade-off there. I come out of an engineering background, and one of the goals of problem solving is to solve the problem. And if solving the problem requires you to be able to communicate, then communicating becomes part of that technical skill. If you need to give a presentation, presentations become part of that technical skill. So what we did is when we look at our program, I look at this bullet list, and other than some of the business models, we do a lot of it already at Roger Williams. We start programming in terms of projects freshman year. They give presentations freshman year. Now, obviously, there's a difference between a freshman level presentation where you're really happy that they can get PowerPoint that's not black letters on a brown background. And then you move up to senior level presentations where they're actually trying to sell their project to a client. So we do incorporate that throughout our 4 years. We have our senior design process is a 2-semester effort where we bring in a client from the outside, and it's up to the student team to develop their requirements, develop their timeline, determine what constitutes a successful project, and then they turn that over to the client at the end of the year. At the end of our academic year. So in that process, they learn communication skills, they deal with the client who's changing requirements. So again, it's not a trade-off, it's more in terms of linking them together. Now, one thing that is a problem for us in academia is when industry comes up to us and says, we absolutely, positively must have graduates who know Ruby, which is a programming language. I've been teaching for 25 years. I can give you 30 languages that are an absolute disservice to our students by not teaching them. So when industry tells me you must know Ruby, I interpret that as we have to teach object-oriented programming paradigms. So what we also would like industry to do is recognize that our students come in and they may not know a specific language, but they can solve the problem and have the ability to learn that language far quicker than if you look for somebody who is so specialized that every time their job changes, they are learning something completely brand new from ground zero. So I think, again, it's not a trade-off of technical and readiness skills. It's being able to mirror them and match them together in a better way that we understand what the requirements of industry are, and industry kind of understands the capabilities of the university to provide those needs.
All right. So as we swing over back to our dynamic industry duo. Do you want your entry-level IT employees to be an asset immediately or in 5 years?
Yeah, that would be immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, there's not. There's realistic expectations, I think, about you know, what somebody that's just starting out in their career can do. They're an investment. I appreciated that part of the report saying it's not just interns. Interns, you kind of know what you're getting. For us, I mean, there's not a huge difference between an intern and somebody that's green straight out of college or just starting their career. That's an investment either way. And so what you're trying to do is make good investments. And yeah, I'd say five years is way too long. So yeah, I mean, they're going to be, you know, becoming a valued contributor within hopefully months. There's the full recognition and acknowledgement that when I hire somebody that's at entry level, I'm going to be training them. I have dedicated people doing nothing but that, just training them. That's fine. I don't have the expectation that they will have experience with certain technologies. I guess I'd like that if I could find that, but it's not. I can't find that, so I'm fine with just training for the technologies. I'd much rather select people who, you know, have those workforce readiness skills, and that's what's going to make them a good investment. Because it's going to take you some time to train them in the specific technologies. But I think there might be, I think part of the confusion might be from a failure to make certain distinctions between certain kinds of jobs. And I think it's both employers and maybe in the, you know, academia and the training communities. There are different kinds of jobs, and they don't all have the same requirements. I guess that was one of the sections of the report. Some of the jobs really are about the technology, and I could see an employer, if they correctly identify their job is one of that type, saying, "Look, I just need somebody who knows this technology, this skill, because that is what they're going to be doing. And when the technology changes, that's right, they're going to need to learn a new skill, right?" But then there are other kinds of jobs where that doesn't matter as much, and the technology is going to be changing more quickly, and there are other things that are more fundamental. And I think both the employers would probably be better served in recognizing which kind of job do they have that would help them make better selections. And then the students and people training them also need to make those distinctions too and say, what do I want to do? What am I going to be prepared for?
Peter, I'm guessing you can't wait 5 years either.
Yeah, 5 years is awesome. Loaded question. That's really not the case. And right immediately, entry level hires. You know, we use technologies, many of the technologies that have been trained in the universities, but we also built our own web frameworks and different things on top of that. We use specialized software packages to deploy our insurance systems. They need to be educated on that as well. But what we look for is them to be able to, and we've built training programs that will bring them right through that. What we found, which is really a tribute to the universities that we work with and that we get students from, is that they get to be productive, almost what I'll call an FTE-like person on a project within a year. And that's pretty impressive, actually, when you look at the technologies that we're using and how complex that systems are. So it is working in the universities. I do agree with Tony's point, though, about it's not, you can't sacrifice that depth, because if you sacrifice the depth, you're really not going to get to that year, because we're going to have to train them basic programming skills or something else that they didn't get. So you have to have workforce readiness as well as the technical skills education going through that. So we've been very successful. We do quite a bit of entry-level hiring, and we measure that. And every student's different, and we do aptitude tests to make sure when they come in, believe it or not, there are college graduates out there that really don't have a CS degree that don't have the aptitude for it, so we screen those out. But for the most part, it's been very successful. We actually did an experiment, where we hired a couple of folks who really didn't have hardly any programming skill coming out of college. Had an IT degree, but really no skill to speak of. Maybe they did a Hello World application, but that was about it. But they had good workforce readiness skills, because they were a good communicator. They would culturally fit with our organization well, so we felt they had good aptitude. So we actually put them through the program, and they've progressed just a little bit longer than the others. So it is possible to leverage that, but prefer to have the technical skills as well as both. I mean, we want it all, right? So instead of people looking
over. So back to our universities, and this goes to another one of the recommendations. Could your department increase the number of computer science or CIS minors to increase the number of tech-savvy graduate?
At Roger Williams, this is a big effort that we have ongoing. It's been ongoing for about 4 or 5 years now. We actually have, in addition to the computer science major, within my program, we have a 15-credit computer science program and an 18-credit computer science program. If a student completes the 18 credits, they get formally recognized with a computer science minor. If they do the 15-credit program, it gets annotated on their degree that they filled in something that we call a core concentration. Over time, and under President Farish, there's been a big push, especially for the students in the liberal arts, to also take one of the professional major or professional minors. So we are getting a lot of our students coming now from some business schools come in. We get a lot of the liberal arts, the English majors, history majors, coming in and taking our one of our two programs. So yeah, we have increased it. We're working to increase it. And right now, we probably have the same amount of minors as we do majors. So it's a big part of our program.
Yes, absolutely. And as you heard earlier, we're working with Lee Pichette to do that. We already do have a minor, but we hadn't advertised it heavily. And actually, the two minors that we're working on with Lee are devised with more industrial input as to what is needed. And it occurs to me that would satisfy or help you with these sorts of critical thinking employees with broader skills could also come in with enough technical skills to come up to speed and more quickly. So absolutely, we have a very large and convoluted spreadsheet for the president and provost to figure out what resources are needed, and we're aiming for that.
State school, after all, right?
Right. And one thing I should mention that's a really neat feature at URI is that students can declare their own minors. It's called a faculty-directed minor. All they need is a signature from one faculty member and the dean of the college. And that's probably how we're going to ramp up these two minors before we go through the long process of making them permanent at the institution. So.
All right. So as you pass that over to our industry folks, so how do you inspire more students to explore and enter IT careers other than by your mere living examples?
Yes, that's that. Well, you know, we probably don't really interact with many of them before they're sort of at our door. I think there's probably two aspects of that. There's a piece where it's actually kind of important that they're somewhat inspired before I meet them. I mean, if somebody has even the barest exposure to programming, and you know, they realize that, okay, they can tell the computer what to do, and the computer's gonna, if it can, it's gonna do exactly what they told it to do, and that they can apply that skill for any myriad of outcomes, whether it's amusement, or art, or helping people become more productive in business, or you know, cure diseases, or send people to space, or whatever. If that lack of constraint, you know, lack of constraints in the medium itself doesn't inspire them, then they probably shouldn't be programming. But once they do have that level, I think, where industry can come in and really kind of shepherd these people through their careers is by, you know, having them cast their vision a little bit further out and say, okay, you know what you can do today, but look at how it can be a little bit easier. Look at how the boundaries of what is feasible for you with your current skill keep getting expanded, pushed out farther and farther because you can do this even better than you could yesterday, right? And here are some better tools. Like somebody who's driven to dig, you know, to mine, and all they've had is a shovel, and then they have a backhoe. It's like they, you know, they're thrilled with that, right? So that's the kind of inspiration that I think industry can provide, is just enabling them to do a good job and to do it better and better each day.
Peter, I'm guessing your best hires are the people who have a passion for it.
Absolutely. For those of us that have worked in IT, and I've done it for a long time, I mean, what really drives you is solving problems and then putting solutions in. That moment where you put a system in place and it works and it does the function that you were planning for, and where your user community really likes it, that's what drives IT and people. But to inspire more people to go into the field, I think put a plug-in for CS4RI, that's a great program. That's really going to spark some interest and inspire people to go into the field. And I think for those of you that haven't gotten involved in it, you might want to take a look at this. It's an interesting program, especially long-term, as was noted earlier about the state in terms of getting more feeders into our system, driving more students to the universities to get into the programs. I've told this story before, but I'll probably tell it again. Amiga is actually part of the CSR4RI program. It also gets our employees involved, so they're getting involved. They're going to help with the schools and do different things. So we're going to support that as an organization because it's going to help us to stay local with our jobs and kind of get feeders in. But my own story in terms of how I got interested in IT is many years ago, pretty old. When I was at Bryant, Bryant has an interesting, the way they organize their IT, their programs was you take 2 years of pretty much general classes all the way through before you really get to your major, and one of those classes was an IT program. I took that program and I went in as an accounting major, which is pretty typical at Bryant. But as soon as I took the IT program, I was like, fucked. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed what it was all about. And then I was like, I switched immediately and went into IT and graduated in IT. I think when students at the high school level and K through 12 level are exposed to what it can really do and how the iPad works or how the iPhone, how things are actually functioning, they're going to get enthused about it, and then they're going to get inspired and want to go into the field. So it's an interesting STEM approach, and I know some folks have met Andre earlier, who does a lot of work in STEM. It sounds like, I think this program is going to have that effect. I think it's going to be really interesting. I've seen a lot of them around that didn't really take hold, don't seem to drive as much. This one, I think, has got a lot of legs to it, so hopefully we'll see it materialize.
Well, this leads us to our bonus question, which is for everybody. You can all take it one by one. How do we create an ongoing communication feedback loop between Rhode Island business and CS and CIS programs?
Yeah, this is, there's really not a single solution to this because you have to approach it from a lot of different perspectives. One of the biggest approaches that we can do and keep on going is something like this report. And that's why I want to thank Joe for this, because I'm writing my annual assessment of how our education at Roger Williams worked, how my computer science program does, and I've got 8 bullets that I can now say we do or we don't do, and I can use that to drive changes that we make. But there's a lot of different ways to approach it. We have a professional advisory board for our CS program. They bring in information of what industry needs are, but there's other ways to do it. All the universities, they have projects. Submit a project and you'll get to see what the students can actually do. It's almost like a free internship. So if you have a project that, a shoebox kind of thing that you would really, really like to do it if you had 4 people to put on it, well, a lot of the CS programs have 4 people that they can put on it. So you can give feedback to the schools that way. You can volunteer, well, not volunteer, you can try to be an adjunct faculty member, again, to teach one section of a course just to see what it is that we do, what it is that our students can do. You can bring that. We have an adjunct faculty member now at Roger Williams who actually uses some of his work projects as sort of screenings for what students can and can't do in terms of what his company is looking for. So there are those kinds of things. The biggest way, obviously, is to have input is to hire our graduates. So if you start hiring our graduates and tell us what's missing, that gives us a little bit more incentive to actually change as well. But again, it's academic. We can do an independent study in the time frame of a semester, but to build a program takes a little bit longer time, as Joan was referencing. I mean, there's things that are high speed, low speed, glacial speed, and academic speed. So you want to be able to kind of work with faculty members to kind of get into that higher speed mode rather than, say, create a formal program, which could take years once it goes through the academic rigors because of the requirements we have in terms of university accreditations.
See how long you can bypass the administration.
Right, basically.
Yeah.
So, all of the above, again, but also be sure to call the department chairs and ask how you can help, or if you have insights into what you think we should be doing. We have an advisory board for our department, so you could call up and perhaps volunteer for that. I also wanted to mention again that all of the after-school initiatives that are going on, many of them now are becoming mature and robust enough that they're looking at the K through 12, K through 20, actually, educational systems, and trying to see how they can link the learning objectives in these semi-structured environments to recruit and retain students, and thereby provide feedback to the schools, and the schools provide feedback into the program. So we have really a patchwork quilt of industry, after-school programs, formal programs, everything from kindergarten through PhD. You can enter and volunteer and be involved on any level. And I can tell you that those of us in the educational systems are listening. We want your input, so and perhaps we need to have some more events like this. You know, where we have these conversations. I think that could foster communication between industry and academia.
Yeah, those are all good suggestions. There's not just one answer. I guess I'll focus on the internship. I was kind of surprised in the results that there weren't more people taking advantage of the internship. And I guess it's partly because not all internships are created equal, I guess. You know, there's some students that maybe they're savvy enough to know that they actually need some real world experience, and they're just also looking to make some money during the summer, and so it's that kind of independent thing. We've had success in hiring people who are interns and then became full-time employees. Various schools. I think what's worked best is when the internships were actually part of the formal educational program. That way there's that connection. There's opportunity for interaction around what's working, what's not, what did they get out of it, what do you hope that the next person will get out of it, and refining that process. That's especially important because, you know, maybe it's different for, you know, we said 50% of those companies are larger than 100 employees and 50% were less. The bigger companies probably looking more long term, but those smaller companies, you know, they're running a business, and you know, we can't look 10 years down the line. We're just hoping to still be around, right? So we have to look at shorter time frames for that return on investment. And so an internship, that's probably a good time frame because you're thinking, okay, here's somebody that's going to start. They're going to work for 3 months, whatever. Maybe they haven't graduated yet if they're a rising, you know, a senior. Okay, but next year, I can wait 12 months. They're going to come back, and if I have evaluated them, if they've done well, at least I'll know what they can do. I've vetted them, and then, you know, it's good for them because then they're, you know, maybe looking for a job. That's the kind of time frame that a small business can probably tolerate, and it's a good opportunity for keeping that discussion going.
Yeah, I echo a lot of what's been said. Yeah, we work a little bit with a few of the universities in an advisory role, if you will, of looking at curriculums and that type of thing. Others, we work with the career office. We can probably set that up a little bit with more of the universities in the area. Because I do like what we're all submitting, your presentation on, you know, submitting our requirements in terms of
TechHire.org.
Yeah, I'm assuming we've already submitted, but I hope to find out. That's a good way to communicate kind of what we're looking for skills-wise and whatever, so as a business. Back to the internship, we'd like to mention we have internships, use them a little bit, but that training curve for some of our specialty areas and the drain on some of the more seasoned people, we haven't figured that out yet. That's definitely something as an organization we have to figure out, but we're in the middle of some major efforts that are forcing us to delay on that. But I hear that from my managers saying, yeah, well, if I take on an intern, I'm going to lose productivity for my senior folks. And that's just something that we just need to solve. We just haven't figured that out. And it might be a partnership between the universities and us to try and make sure that it'll work, because I do think that's a good feeder. So it's all right.
Good. Well, good discussion. How about a hand for our panel here? Does anybody have any questions for our members of our panel? I'll grab the microphone. As I come over to you, just tell me your name and what you do. And have.
I'm Lauren Perdio, and I am a portfolio manager at Western Shield, Rhode Island. I've had the opportunity to be an educator. I have been in many different roles in IT. And you know, one of the things, I love the idea of going at that K-12. One of my observations as a parent has been that many of the teachers have no concept and they have no idea about how to introduce these kids to technology. They don't use it. They might not even know how to use the computers in their classroom. Are there things happening outside of the computer science departments to start to bring those younger K-12 educators?
Just like you or I, our faculty has been discussing different ways to teach within our School of Education. We were kind of surprised that Rhode Island itself does not have a state certification for computer science teachers at the K-12 level. And that's part of our problem, is if there was a certification already in existence, we can map to it. So we're trying to work at it. And to be honest, I think 8 years is optimistic if you wanted to get something actually certified at that state level. But we've been really working at that. We've been trying to really push our minor to students, our introductory to computer programming course. We really do emphasize that for our School of Secondary Ed. And we've actually seen an increase in the number of student teachers who have been taking that course. So we think there is some potential there.
All right. Does someone have a question for our industry people? Yes? No? Industry?
Right here.
Okay. Go ahead. Tell me your name and what do you do?
My name is Ann Oskell, and I'm a professor at Rhode Island College, and I'm also a president of the Computer Science Teacher Association of Rhode Island. So my question to industry is, how valuable is a college degree for you? And when I talk about that, I have students who may have been in IT at one time, have unfortunately lost their jobs, and then find for some industries that they can't go anywhere, even though they have a great deal of training, they're kind of, they can't do anything unless they actually get their degree now. So I'm asking you that because I see that there are different pathways to this, and what do you see, what's currently happening?
All right. Let's, who wants to tackle it first? Peter.
For the entry-level positions that we had talked about, we're looking for a bachelor's degree. We hold to that pretty much, at least with a development position. It's not all positions in our department. But we also, equivalent experience. So if somebody was in IT before, you know, they left the industry, did something different, but have a lot of experience, we would definitely look at them as well, because that's there. It's not a hard requirement. It's experience as well. So if they have equivalent experience, we actually have quite a few people in our department who began with an associate's degree back 20, 30 years ago. And so they don't have a bachelor's degree, but they're actually some managers who are in that camp. So yeah, we look at all the experience that somebody might have.
Chris?
Yeah, I'd say that I think my answer is similar. I think for the non-entry level, a degree or formal educational background is relatively unimportant, because the primary thing that I look at is experience. And so what have they done? And you know, especially if they have some experience, they're gonna stand or fall on that, not on an educational degree. At the entry level, I'd say it is more important. We use it as a signal, as a differentiator. And ironically, perhaps, the area of the degree actually isn't as important as you might think. I mean, when I look at a CS grad, you know, I'm glad that they're going to have a certain canon of educational experience. You know, but if somebody has, we have like a couple of our folks have chemical engineering degrees. They just want to make a switch into computer science because they took some computer science classes and they like programming. Okay, that's fine. We can backfill what you missed, you know, in an educational program. But, you know, if you actually, you know, went through and you learned, you might actually be able to think clearly. And that's what matters. You know, a law degree, that's great. Okay, you don't like doing law anymore. I don't blame you. So you want to be, you want a program, fine. But you learn to think clearly, make arguments. So it's not so much there's a certain level of benefit that comes from the CS degree itself, but there's a substantial benefit that just comes from that educational experience and what it correlates with in terms of maturity.
All right. Will you take old, washed-up journalists? Looking to make a switch. We're getting close to time here, so I'm guessing that our panelists are not going to be running off. I don't know, maybe have a few minutes if people want to raise some questions. Do we have time for one more? One more. So someone with a burning question, and this woman in the back has been waving at me, and tell me your name first of all. What do you do?
My name is Susan Ahlstrom. I'm the Director of Development at the Academy for Career Exploration, and I don't have a question so much as a comment. Again, I want to emphasize some of the things we've been talking about this morning. The Academy for Career Exploration is a public charter school, and we serve a demographic that is in need of the tools and education that we're providing. But I want to.
Nobody said anything about an ad.
What I want to really advocate is what is happening here today and how critical it is in order to make the change that will see the results that are needed in industry, et cetera. And we have worked with the industry partners, the educational partners, and that collaboration is so critical, and we are so grateful to people like Bridge Technical Talent and Amiga. In trying to identify ways to continue the internships, build those essential skills into curriculum as well as get IT. My point is that, as Janet stated, it is so critical that business get involved and advocate for changes that need to happen, including how we hire teachers, how we credential teachers who are teaching in our public school system. We have a highly qualified teacher that we've been trying to hire that we have actively engaged, who's an industry professional who has so much to offer to teach these skills and engage our students. But we need to make changes on the state level to our educational system that will allow us to hire those teachers with the skills that can educate for computer science. So if I had a question, if I need a question,
I'm okay. Just going to say that you didn't have a question, but you're on the committee. You're on the
committee. Okay. We invite you all to continue to stay actively involved, and thank you for all that you're doing here.
All right. Well, thanks, everybody. This was great. I hope everybody got something out of it.
And thanks so much to you. Round of applause for Steve, too. Time over the last few weeks to prepare for this and come in today and get this conversation started. It was very, very informative and a great first step in this endeavor. So thank you so much. I also want to, you know, get some Bridge swag for you, so make sure you don't leave rid of that. Did you have some stuff?
Yeah, just a couple of housekeeping / closing remarks. You all have print copies of the report. You can go to techcollective.org, bridge-talent.com. Download it, or if you want more hard copies, I don't think we have too many left today, but let us know, we'll get them to you if that's not a problem. Go to TechRI's website and put in your information, because we need that. That's our compass going forward. So if you have any questions, Jen and Lee are always here to answer. A couple of other things going on here for the industry. One is, I think I'm speaking to the choir a little bit, but we have an IT and a bioscience industry overview presentation going on here on Wednesday at Tech Collective. So if you want to learn more about IT or bio, I think you guys are pretty familiar all about it. But it's here, it's 8:30 to 10:30. Employers and educators, if you want to know about the workforce system programs, things that Commerce RI are doing, the Commerce Workforce Board is doing, the Real Jobs is doing to help employers and industry grow here in Rhode Island, there's going to be a presentation here on June 22nd from 8:30 to 10:30.
So if you want to learn more about other incentives for you, I would highly encourage you to come here. That same night, we're having a GitHub workshop. So if you're a tech team, you want to know about GitHub, or just, you know, come out with a bunch of other people doing the same thing you are, it's going to be 5:30 to 7:30 on June 22nd. And last but not least, go right to the soft skills. We have an effective communications workshops going on 6:28. It's 8:30 to 1 o'clock here at Tech Collective, or actually at Bryant University, your alma mater, or it's at the EDC. So we run this workshop several times. It's highly popular. And we only have a few spots, I think 5 or 6 spots left. But if you or any of your colleagues or teams need some effective communications training, this is the place to go. So any follow-up, all information on our website, you can contact Joe or I or anything about today. Or if you're looking to get involved with some of the K-12, K-16 programs, we know where to send you. So thank you very much.
Get involved. If your business, if you're hiring, make sure you check out Tech IRI. And don't be afraid to get involved. Tech Life is putting together, at some point, we're going to try to build the speakers bureau so people that want to get out there and get in the community like the Celtic folks that are meeker doing. You know, don't be afraid to contact Tech Collective and go to your own K-12 system. You know, you're wherever you are, you're in East Providence, no matter where you go to your own school, and you can evangelize about this so that by the time they get to Chris's door, they will know about IT. Or wait till they get there. We want to prep them early, right?
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming. Thanks.